The following video presents the step-by-step techniques of the standard primary total knee replacement surgery. The patient is placed in the supine position. The tourniquet is well padded and placed on the thigh as high as possible. There is a rectangle positioner placed on the lateral side of the thigh, allowing the maintenance of the vertical position of the thigh when the knee is flexed. There is a small round positioner placed at the ankle of the non-operated extremity. Flex the operated knee to the 90 degrees.
That is mighty fine.
Apply the non-steroid plastic U-drape just at the edge of the tourniquet.
Okay, we can get antibiotics in.
Okay. 2 grams?
Yeah, 2 grams.
All right, we're in business. Use the U positioner to hold the lower extremity for the prep. The operated extremity is first scrubbed with soap and brush and then painted twice with chloroprep. When the prep is completed, it is time for sterile draping. Lift the extremity with the sterile towel and remove the U positioner. While the lower extremity is still supported with the sterile towel, place the down sheet first. Apply the plastic stockinette. Unfold it as high as possible. Be careful not to break the sterility, especially getting close to the plastic U drape. Place the sterile plastic U-drape carefully enclosing the edge of the stockinette. Cover the top of the U-drape with the top sheet. Place the large paper U-drape. As the last piece of draping, place the large extremity drape. Make a small cut in the stockinette right over the knee. That would allow the air to escape when you rub the knee with a carbon wrap. Use the carbon wrap to wrap up the foot and the lower leg. Bring to the operating field all the tubing, such as pulse lavage, suction, and the electrocautery. Cut out the window and the stockinette, exposing the operating area. You're ready for the marking. Carefully mark the superior and inferior hole of the patella, as well as the medial edge. Mark the point 3 fingers below the inferior pole of the patella. That will be your lower end of the incision. Mark the point two fingers above the superior part of the patella, this will be the proximal end of your incision. Draw the incision line connecting the two points in the middle parapatellar line. Note that all the markings are done with the knee in extension. Flex the knee back to the 90 degrees and cover the operative area with iodine foil.
Official timeout.
To exsanguinate the leg, rub the lower extremity with the S mark starting from the foot and working your way up. Inflate the tourniquet to 350 millimeters of mercury and remove the S mark. Carry the incision through the entire thickness of the skin in one smooth move. Then dissect the subcutaneous tissue until you reach the joint capsule.
You said my head was in the way? No, I'm sorry about the light was going to get in the way of it.
In this video, we used bipolar electrocautery to obliterate small vessels.
You get better video when you don't use the light. Because, you know, right? What? Yes.
Enter the joint just middle to the patellar ligament and extend the incision down to the tibia. Invert the blade and carry the incision from the distal up on the tibia, extending the incision by another 2 to 3 centimeters. Extend the incision proximally along the patella, split the vastus medialis muscle at the 45 degree angle. Then finish opening the joint. Position the rake retractor on the middle side at the level of the joint line. Use electrocautery to perform subperiosteal elevation of the MCL.
I'll take a cob elevator in a few minutes.
Use cob elevator to complete the subperiosteal elevation. Extend the leg and reposition the rake retractor to expose the middle edge of the incised joint capsule. Remove the synovium from the middle aspect of the joint. Try to do it keeping the excised synovium in one piece. Place the Army Navy retractor right below the patellar tendon. You may need to use a knife to perform a puncture if the retractor doesn't go in easily. Then partially remove the fat band from the anterior aspect of the knee joint.
Curve mail first.
open the suprapatellar pouch with curved Mayo scissors. We like to use the patellar clamp for a better grip to evert the patella. However, doing so, you must pay close attention not to tear the patellar tendon. Evert the patella while flexing the knee at the same time. If you find that the soft tissues are under too much tension, you may successfully relax it by slightly extending the incision. Place the Richardson retractor in the suprapatellar pouch to clean the fat pad. Place the Holman retractor on the medial side of the femur, protecting the MCL. Then remove the osteophyte on the medial side of the knee with the straight 3/4-inch osteotome. Use the 1/4-inch curved osteotome to remove the osteophyte on the posterior medial femur. Switch the Holman retractor to the lateral side and remove the osteophyte as needed. Use 3/4-inch curved osteotome to open the femoral notch. Remove both cruciate ligaments. Carefully place the double-angle Holman retractor behind the posterior aspect of the tibial surface and dislocate the knee joint forward. Again, if the soft tissues appear tense, slight extension of the incision will release it. Remove the remnants of the anterior fat from the patellar tendon. Place the Holman retractor on the lateral aspect of the tibial joint surface to protect the patellar tendon and patella itself. Remove the lateral and then the medial meniscus. Position the tibial cutting guide. Position the top part on the tibial eminence and secure it with a pin. Slide the cutting guide against the bone. Align the long part of the guide with the tibial spine to ensure the horizontal cut, as well as two fingers away from the bone at the level of the ankle joint to ensure the posterior slope. Use the angel wing to establish the thickness of the cut. Once the cutting guide is properly positioned, secure it with pins. Once the cutting guide is in place, remove the rest of the alignment guides. Cut and remove the tibial joint surface with the oscillating saw. Once the cut is completed, remove the cross pin and the cutting guide, leaving the two parallel pins in place. You will need them in case you need to recut the tibia lower. As you cut through the soft tissues in the posterior aspect of the knee, make sure to point the blade of the knife down towards the cut tibial surface and not towards the back of the knee.
What? It's all relative. Can I have an oscillating saw? It's all relative. poker knife. Let me see, a 5.
6. It's pretty big.
Okay, I can't tell. Knife. Let me see a 6.
Measure the size of a tibial base plate.
That's 6. That's very nice. Okay, let's take everything out.
Remove all the attractors and extend the knee to check the tibial cut. With the knee in extension, insert the alignment rod. It should point to the second metatarsal bone.
Very good. Now, more importantly,
remove the tibial sizer and check the gap between the cut tibia and the femoral joint surface. It should be approximately 1 centimeter. If it's less, then you need to recut the tibia lower. If the gap is sufficient, you can remove the remaining pins. That completes the tibial cut.
You guys see right there?
We start the femoral cut with opening the femoral canal. We use it as the original alignment reference. Insert the femoral rod with the pre-attached anterior referencing base into the femoral canal. Align the reference base parallel to the tibia. Then secure it with pins. Check the alignment by slightly lifting the femur. Attach the femoral cutting guide with the anterior femoral reference guide and adjust the height of the cut. Tighten the screws to secure the position of the cutting guide. Once the anterior cutting guide is in place, cut the anterior femur. Once the anterior cut is completed, place the 10mm distal cutting guide and secure it with pins. Detach and remove the anterior cutting guide along with the base and the femoral alignment rod. Position the Z retractor to protect the patellar tendon. Use the 1-inch straight osteotome to protect the tibial surface and perform the distal cut of the lateral condyle. Reposition the zero tractor to the medial side to protect the MCL. Again, use the straight osteotome to protect the tibia and perform the cut to the medial condyle. As you cut, make sure that the cuts are straight, as the blade has a tendency to bend away from the bone. Remove the cross pins and distal cutting guide. Leave the parallel pins in place in case you need to recut the distal femur.
Okay, let's see, spacing.
Extend the knee and check the gap. Check the middle lateral stability and make sure that you get a full extension. Recheck it for different sizes to establish the best fit. If the cut is sufficient, you can remove the remaining pins.
Don't give me that last one again. The one I just gave that was bent. That's all right.
Measure the level of the posterior cut. Position the posterior end chamfer cutting block and secure it with pins. Protect the patellar tendon with the Z-retractor and perform the posterior cut of the lateral condyle. Insert the 1-inch straight osteotome to protect the tibia and perform the 45-degree cuts. Switch the Z-retractor to the medial side to protect the MCL and perform the cuts on the medial condyle. Again, reposition the straight osteotome to perform the 45-degree cut on the medial condyle. Remove the Z-retractor and the osteotome and complete the rest of the cuts. Once all the cuts are completed, remove the cutting block and all the pins. Use the laminar spreader to open the joint space. At first, insert the laminar spreader from the lateral side. This will give you an excellent access to the back of the medial aspect of the knee.
Subtle lines work. You'll get a three-quarter inch curved osteotome right in a couple of them.
Remove the remnants of the cruciate ligaments and the menisci.
Coker. So you can see how it's contiguous.
While removing the medial meniscus, be very careful not to damage the MCL. Use the 3/4 inch curved osteotome to remove the posterior osteophytes.
Okay.
Reposition the laminar spreader to the medial side and open again the joint space. This will give you an excellent access to the back of the lateral aspect of the knee. Remove the remnants of the lateral meniscus. Use the 3/4 inch curved osteotome to remove the posterior osteophytes from the lateral condyle. Once the posterior osteophyte and the remnant of the menisci are removed, you can remove the laminar spreader. Measure and compare the flexion and extension gaps. Check their stability in extension, full flexion, and mid flexion. Also recheck if the extremity reaches full extension. Cut out the femoral notch. Position the center punch guide over the opening to the femoral canal. Secure it with pins.
Okay, now I have a osteotome.
Protect the tibial surface with 1-inch straight osteotome and perform the cuts with the oscillating saw. Perform the final cut with the chisel. Remove the center punch guide.
Run. Big. Yep. Big boy. 30. What's up? Drum up.
Insert the femoral trial.
Double angle.
Position the double angle Harman in the femoral notch and dislocate the tibia forward. Retract the patellar tendon with a Harman retractor. Position the tibial plate trial and secure it with pins. Position the guide and perform the tibial punch. Insert the trial spacer and reduce the knee joint. Check the stability and motion of the knee joint with the trial implants. We check it again in full extension, full flexion and mid flexion. Extend the knee and evert the patella. Attach the cocker to the soft tissues on the medial edge of the patella to help with the eversion. perform the lateral release as necessary. Place two sharp towel clips in the patellar tendon and the quadriceps muscle tendon for a better grip and stabilization of the patella during the cut. As necessary, use the rongeur to remove the osteophytes from the patella. We prefer to cut the patella with the free-handed cut, leaving about 10 millimeters of patella behind. Position and size the patellar drill guide and drill the holes.
Yeah, 30 is perfect. Have a drill. Thank you.
As we finish drilling the holes in the patella, we start mixing cement for the entire prosthesis. Apply the patella trial. Revert the patella and check the patella tracking. Once the alignment, stability and tracking are confirmed, remove all the trial implants. Irrigate the joint copiously with pulse lavage and dry it out. We use pressure suction tape for the cementing part of procedure. Apply the cement to the femur and pre-pressurize it with your finger. Also add small amount of cement on the implant itself. Be careful not to use too much. Apply the femoral implant. Remove the excess of the cement using smooth forceps. Re-impact the prosthesis for the second time and then remove the excess of the cement. Place the double ankle home on the tractor in the femoral notch. This time protect the real implant with the gauze. Use the home on the tractor to retract the patellar tendon. Again irrigate and dry the tibia. Insert the Fraser suction tip into the tibia's punched hole and leave it there for the cement application. The vacuum will help to incorporate the cement into the bone structure. Apply the cement to the table surface and pre-pressurize it with your finger. Apply a small amount of cement to the table base plate and insert the implant. Remove the excess of the cement with smooth forceps. Insert the spacer trial and reduce the knee. Irrigate and dry the patella. Place the cocker on the middle aspect of the patella for the better grip. Apply the cement to the patellar surface and pre-pressurize it with your finger. Apply the patellar implant and press it with a clamp. Remove the excess of the cement with the smooth forceps. When the cement hardens, remove the polymer spacer and irrigate the joint. Place the double angle home on the tractor and dislocate the tibia forward. Remember to protect the femoral component with the gauze. Place the home on the tractor on the lateral aspect of the tibia and retract the patellar tendon. Carefully inspect the area around the implant for any excess of the cement and remove it with 1/4-inch curved osteotome. Clean the tibial plate and apply the polymer component. Remove all the retractors and reduce the knee joint. Irrigate the joint and insert the drain. For the knee replacement, we like to use double drains.
They're bringing in next door, John?
We close the joint capsule and the vastus medialis fascia with the number 1 Vicryl suture. We anchor the first figure of 8 suture to align the angle of the vastus medialis cut. We close the fascia of the vastus medialis muscle with 2 layers of running suture.
Right in here. Okay. Right, yeah, someone got my attention. Romain, yes.
Pavel. Dr. Pavel.
Thank you. Yeah. I hear that. Count correct.
Thank you.
Training starts early.
We close the rest of the joint capsule with a figure of 8 interrupted sutures.
Oh, you know what, Paul? just to get a good close. Let's get that light in here now. That one. Just so I can get this layer. Hold on, what kind of research did you do? I would like to have some answer for him. We researched on how to get an IRB. We found that it was hard.
We use 2-0 Vico inverted interrupted sutures for the subcutaneous closure. Then we follow with staples on the skin.
I got the weight set up.